down before our God and turn. This is true. This
come and rest on our threes. Come on, sing that out. We release the glory of the Lord right now. Oh, come and rest in this place. Oh, come and rest on our threes. Glory of the Lord right now. We come and rest in this place. Oh, come and rest in this place. Oh, we release the glory of the Lord right now. Come and rest in this place. We come and rest on our praise. Oh, we release the glory of the Lord right now. Come and rest in this place. Come and rest on our praise.
Suffered in my place.
see your face. I exalt your name. You are holy. I exalt your name. You are worthy. I exalt your name.
Oh, the glory of Come and rest in this place. Come and rest in this place. Oh, the glory of the Lord is here right now. Come and rest in this place. Come and rest in this place. Come on and rest. Oh, the glory of the Lord is here right now. Oh, come and rest in this place. Come and rest in this place. Oh, the glory of the Lord is here right now. Oh, come and rest in this place. Oh, come and rest in this. Come on, if you need rest this night. Oh, the glory of the Lord is here right now. Oh, come and rest in this place. Oh, come and rest in this place. Oh, the glory of the Lord is here right now. Oh, come and rest in this place. Oh, come and rest in this place. Oh, the glory of the Lord is here right now. Oh, come and rest in this place. Come and rest in this place.
Resting place. We can rest in you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your presence. Thank you, Lord. There's someone here tonight that you have been in a place of making a real big decision. And you know in your heart what the Lord wants you to do. And he says to step out by faith because he's got you. He knows where you're going. He knows where he wants to take you. And all he wants you to do is follow him. So rest in him. Find your rest in him.
Yes.
Because you know what your heart is telling you to do. And he says, follow hard after me. You're going to know when you leave this place tonight exactly what you need to do. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Oh, Lord, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your presence. Father, I thank you for each and every one that is here right now, oh God. We've come to dwell together in unity, lifting up the name of Jesus, lifting up you, Father, who you are. You are great and mighty and worthy of all praise, all honor, and all glory. We bless you, Lord. We bless you. We thank you for your presence. Thank you for your love. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. And once again, Father, I thank you that no one will leave here the same way that they came, in Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Father. Quickened in their minds, quickened in their bodies, and quickened in their spirits, in the name of Jesus. We love you. We bless you and honor you and give you all praise. We give you all praise. In the precious, lovely name of Jesus, we all sit together. Amen. 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 What a lovely God we serve. Amen. He is mighty. I think it was 2 or 3 weeks ago, Sheila, that you wrote that song. On the way to church, they got to Chester. They were, you know, they live in Greenville. They were in Chester. And the Lord told her to get a pen and a paper. And she did. She wrote that song between Chester and here. She had the words, she had the music, the melody, everything. And when they got here that day, she sang that song. I just think that that is just awesome. That's the way it should be. Creativity in God's people. It should just flow easy and natural. Amen. It's so good to see you in the house of the Lord tonight. And most of all, it's good to be the house of the Lord. We welcome everybody here tonight. We welcome Spirit, Word and Spirit. Word and Spirit. I was just going to say Chester. It's always good to come together as a body. And, you know, the focus this weekend was dwelling together in unity. And that's what we've come to do. Because when we come together and we're one, we're focused in the same direction, and that is with our eyes on Jesus, we come with a great expectation, believing that all things are possible in Jesus. Amen? Amen. It's so good to see you and have you here tonight. And we're going to do things just a little bit different. We're going to receive our offering at the end of service tonight. So right now, I just want you to stand back up. We get good exercise here. I want you to take a few moments and love on somebody and meet somebody that you do not know and love them with the love of the Lord. Can we do that? Let's do that. Let's just love on each other for a few moments. Thank you.
Oh, I know a place, y'all. Ain't nobody crying.
We come back together. I just want to say how much I love my church. I love Open Door. It's all right. As we say it, we love getting jiggy with Jesus. And it definitely has to be a God thing, because sometimes when you look up there in that sound booth, woo-wee, it has got to be a God thing. Because Richard ain't never fell down the steps yet. And you get him and Sandra up there in that tiny little sound booth, mm-mm-mm. God's people ought to be happy people. They ought to have a good time when they come together. Amen? Hallelujah. Well, we're going to be blessed with Miss Iris. She's going to come and minister a song tonight. And after Iris sings, Bishop David will be coming and bringing the word. So right now, I just want us to take a moment to pray for him. And let's honor him, because I don't want to just have to get back up here. I want you just to come on and just, okay? All right. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for this man of God. I thank you for the word, the spirit that dwells within him. I thank you, Father God, that you will just flow through him, your servant, this night. Lord God, that you will just speak through him, that it will go forth with power and authority and demonstration in the name of Jesus. I thank you for your spirit, Father God, just flowing and ministering through him this night. I thank you for him. He is a true gift of God. He is a blessing to this house. He is a blessing to my husband, the pastor of this house. And I thank you, Father God, for the friendship. And I thank you, God, for this church. I speak blessing and favor over them, oh God, that they're rising up and they're doing great and mighty things in Chester. They're going to take the city for you in Jesus' name. And we thank you, Father God, for this night. Let our hearts be open to you. We bless you, we honor you, and give you praise in Jesus' name. We said together, amen. Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Hope y'all been having a good time, because I sure have. Amen. Glory to God. Well, we're going to stand up again. No, y'all not tired, are you? And we're just going to praise the Lord, because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
We're all gathered here in your presence, Lord, with our arms open wide. We've lifted hands, and with open hearts, we welcome you to abide. Until you come, dear Lord, for we are so unworthy to even call on your name. So please, 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 Lord, hear our prayer, and don't let our coming be in vain.
We need you right now, Lord. We need you like we never needed you before, Lord. Yeah. We need you to guide us, to guard us, crown us, govern us, Lord. Lord, just have your way with us, Lord. Holy Spirit, I just love to call on your name.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Amen. Give the Lord another good praise tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, he's worthy. The Lamb of God is worthy. We give you praise. We give you the highest praise, Jesus. Go ahead, put your heart in your hands and give him the highest praise. Father, we thank you for your glory. Thank you for the power of your anointing, Lord. Thank you for your resurrection glory in our lives. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And I want you to look at your neighbor before you're seated and tell them you're not only pretty, but you're pretty important. Hallelujah. You're vital. You're vital. Amen. Hug somebody's neck. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You know, I don't think probably anything has gone as planned tonight. Am I correct about that? Is that right? Yeah, it just kind of seems that way. I don't think we plan these folks breakdancing over here in the service and some of the other things that have been going on. And, of course, there's some things circulating in my spirit this evening, and for those of you that preach the gospel, you'll know exactly how this feels when you've got this thing that you've got it all together and you really believe that you've heard from the Lord, and then at the last minute the Lord starts to mess with you just a little bit, and he messes with you just enough to make you feel just a little out of kilter, right? And so you really don't know which direction to go, and you say, Lord, why do you do that? And God says, well, you're just going to have to trust me now, aren't you? So we're going to do that, but I'm hearing some things with the Lord. This may take 5 minutes. I know that'll make some of you really happy, but it may not take just a few moments here, and then I may preach for 2 hours. I may preach until I see Pastor John come in. Hallelujah. Amen, but we know he's coming in, right? He's on his way as I speak. But I hear the Lord say this, and I just want to be very, very cautious and very respectful and very reverent before the Spirit of the Lord as I say this, because I don't want it to sound like hype to you, because what I'm about to say to you, you've heard it before. Well, let me rephrase. Maybe you thought you heard it before, but maybe we should take heed this evening how we hear. And if we can hear to the point that it causes us to perceive and connect to reality, then something's about to shift in all of our lives. But I'm sitting over here, and the Lord spoke to me something that I just want to communicate to you. But he said to me, David, this is the set time for favor. The Lord said, immeasurable, undeniable, irrevocable, recognizable favor. The kind of favor that will shift in your life in such a dimension that you'll go to bed one night, everything will look one way, my God, and you'll wake up the next morning, and it's like a waterfall of the mercies and the graces of God. Things you've been looking for years and years, and you've never seen them happen, and you've never seen them materialize. I hear the word of the Lord say, it's going to happen in a day. And this is the day, oh, that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice, and we will be glad in it. I don't think God has to do anything else for us, because I believe he finished all the redemptive work. Let me say that so you'll hear my heart. Jesus finished the redemptive work 2,000 years ago on the cross. He didn't finish all the work. He just finished the redemptive work. But we're going to equip you for the work of the ministry. He didn't finish that work. That's your work. That's, you have a labor of love. That's your labor. We're going to labor to enter into the rest of God. That's your work. But when it comes to your standing with the Father, when it comes to your redemptive privileges, praise God, the price has already been paid. Hallelujah. Paid in full by the blood of heaven's Lamb. Bump your neighbor and say, God don't owe anything on me. I'm paid for. My salvation is paid for. My healing is paid for. Hallelujah. I'm a blessed individual. But I heard the word of the Lord say that about favor. Favor. This is a time of immeasurable, undeniable, irrevocable, recognizable favor. Even the people in the world will start to look. And I'm not just talking about material things. You know, we often think about material things. That means I'm going to get that Mercedes I've been praying for, and I'm going to get that new house and all of that stuff. And the Lord said, all of that's just fringe benefits. Those are things that just come along with the blessing, but that in itself is not the blessing. The blessing is a living, breathing person. His name is Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, wave your hands and say, Lord, thank you for the reality and the recognition of you. Hallelujah. We're about to perceive the Lord on a level. As a matter of fact, I believe that's our greatest challenge as believers. It's to perceive the reality of God. How many of you have ever been to church and you heard something declared, you heard something said, and you believed it, and you rejoiced over it, and you celebrated it, and you danced about it, sang about it, and you went home happy and got up the next morning miserable? Well, you're not going to be honest, but all of us have done that one time or another. What happened? Well, just a shift in our focus, that's all. The reality that we experienced while we were in the tangible presence of God was just as much a reality the next morning as it was that evening before. But now all of a sudden our conscience began to shift. Our focus began to shift. We simply just become mindful of something other than God himself. And your consciousness is always your reality. Whatever you're conscious of at the moment, wherever your mind goes, whatever you think upon the most, whatever you give your attention to becomes real to you. Even though it may not be what Jesus has in mind for you, but even as a believer, as a born-again Christian, you connect to it. Hallelujah, and it will start to work in you, and once it starts to work in you, it will flow through you. That's the point of the gospel. How many understand that we're here this evening to receive an engrafted word? Not just a word, an engrafted word. A word that's rooted, a word that's implanted, a word that cannot be taken from us, because that word will do what? Receive the engrafted word, which is able. It's the only thing that is able to save your soul. To bring your mind in the same location in reality that your spirit is already in. How many know that in your spirit, and that's what you are, by the way, you're a breathing spirit in the presence of God. You're also a speaking spirit. But how many know that in your spirit you can't get sick? Spirit can't catch the flu. Spirit don't have runny noses. Amen. The spirit cannot be limited, confined, restricted, or hemmed in. Your spirit is eternal. It's already joined to the Lord. It's already in heavenly places. It's beyond the curse. It's beyond sickness. It's beyond poverty. It's beyond limitation. Your spirit is drenched in the glory and the presence and the power of the anointing. Praise God. Your spirit, man, you are spirit. Somebody might be able to do harm to your physical body, but can't nothing or no one in this world touch who you really are. Hallelujah. You are joined to the Lord and you are one spirit. And not only is your spirit beyond the curse, but there's miracle working power and ability in your spirit. Praise God. There's healing virtue that flows out of your spirit because your spirit is joined to the Lord. You have the ability to take your hands and lay hands on the sick and they will recover whenever you do that out of the realm of spirit by faith. Virtue will begin to flow out of you just like it did Jesus, and it will touch the wounded, it will touch the hurting. But here's the purpose of the gospel. The purpose of the gospel is we're going to get all of that glory that's alive and active and real in your spirit, and we're going to cause that to ascend into your thinking. And we're going to get that alive in your soul. Praise God. And there's going to be a shift in the way that you think. Now, when that anointing hits your head like that, next thing it's going to do is it's going to affect your mouth. And it's going to start coming out in a prophetic utterance. Some of you are about to prophesy on a level that you have never prophesied. Even singers, my God, you're about to sing and write music and decree the gospel on a level that is unprecedented. And I mean, it's not just pretty words. Preachers, you're about to preach on a level that's going to not only astound the church, it's going to astound the world. Oh, they're coming. They're coming. They're coming because of the glory. Praise God. And all of that is within us right now. But God said it's the gospel that will take what's in your spirit and start to bring that into your mind. Now, whenever that anointing starts to operate in your mind, then there's a shift in the way you think. But watch this. There's a shift in what you perceive. Okay? You can go to the hospital and you're standing beside the same bed that all the others are standing beside, and they've called the family in because all they can perceive is death. But there you stand under the influence of the Holy Spirit, and your eyes are open and you're privileged to see what angels see. You can see the glory and the presence of God, the life of God. As a matter of fact, it's breathing not only in your heart, but it's breathing in your soul. And you open up your mouth and you begin to speak, but your words don't come out of your head. Your words come out of your belly. And out of your belly, rivers will begin to flow. Healing begins to course its way through you. And it touches people's lives. Bump your neighbor and say, you're here to make a change. You're here to make a change. You're here to bring forth a difference in people's lives. And it's largely to do with what we perceive. The work is finished. How many of you believe that? Jesus ascended to the right hand of the Father, and he sat down. In the Old Covenant, the Bible says those priests stood daily. And they stood daily because the work was always continual. They could never perfect by those Old Covenant sacrifices which were brought to them, the worshipers. So there was a constant flow of blood and bleeding and dying. It was constant. So they stood. But this man, when he had offered one sacrifice for sin forever, sat down on the right hand of the Father. For by one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. You ought to wave your sanctified hands. Thank God for the blood, and thank God for that one sacrifice that hath perfected us forever. And whenever you are touched by the power of that anointing, all of a sudden your perception opens up. And perception is just simply the ability to recognize sometimes things that others just look right past. There's an anointing here tonight. This is not an ordinary meeting. This is an extraordinary meeting. Why? Because my Father's here. Your Father's here. And His arms are wide open and the grace of God is flowing. There's healing, miracles taking place. Already took place. I'm back there at the back a while ago. And there's a lady from our church. I know Sarah's in here somewhere. And this is the God truth. I'm standing back there worshiping, and of course I won't go through Sarah's story, but her legs had swollen. She didn't get great reports from the doctor and been going through some severe pain in her body and could barely walk. And as I was standing back there worshiping, just out of the corner of my eye, I saw somebody walk by me like this. And I didn't know who it was, so help me God. And the Lord spoke to me and said, that was Sarah. I said, Lord, that's awesome. And so I opened my eyes to see if that was the Lord talking to me. And a few minutes later, Sarah walked back by. And I said, yeah, that is the Lord. And the healing anointing of God, I don't know when it touched her. I just thank God that it touched her. But that same anointing is available. That same anointing is available. I tell you in the name of Jesus, be healed. You are healed. Your bodies are free. Your mind is free. Your money is free. As a matter of fact, the anointing of God is on your mind. Somebody said, I want more money. God said, let me give you more wisdom. You get more wisdom, you get more money, you get more money, you get more ability. But that anointing is here. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus has literally set us on top of the world. And the Lord says, now is the set time. It's a set time for you to take your place in this world, in the kingdom of heaven. Praise God. The Lord says, I just want to affect what you're able to perceive, what you're able to recognize. You remember Jacob? He took the stones of that place and he set them up and used them for a pillow. Remember that? And he laid his head up upon that rock. And when he laid his head upon that rock, immediately he began to dream. See, the only true way to dream, the dream of God, is when you got your head laid in the proper place. And when you lay your head on a rock, then you'll always begin to dream the dream that God has for you. And whenever he dreamed, he saw heaven opened. And there was a ladder let down out of the heavens. And the angels of the Lord were ascending and descending upon that ladder. And immediately Jacob knew, man, heaven and earth are connected. Somebody said the bridge is out. No, the bridge is not out. The bridge is not out. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. When Jesus came into this world with one hand, he reached up and took hold of God the Father. And with the other hand, he reached down and took hold of a hurting, dying humanity. And he looks at the humanity and says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man's coming to the Father but by me. Wave your hands and say, I've got a bridge. I've got a ladder into heaven. Hallelujah. And now I'm privileged to live the ascension life. But if you could see this, Jacob thinks he's in a hard place. And when he's But really, he's not in a hard place. He just thinks he is. But the angels of the Lord are all around him. Heaven is all around him. There's more for him than there are against him. But he did not perceive it and he did not recognize it until he used the stone for a pillow. And when he laid his head upon that stone pillow. How many remember when Jacob awaked out of his sleep? See, that's what will happen. You'll dream the dream of God with your head right there, and then you'll awake out of your sleep. You'll begin to recognize some things. And he woke out of his sleep, and this is what he said. Come here, Jonathan. He said, the Lord is in this place. And I knew it not. There was a whole lot more glory available for me all the time, and I just didn't perceive it. The Lord is in this place. What place? The stone pillow. Jacob wasn't looking around saying, the Lord is in this place. No, he looked at that rock. And he measured the rock. He analyzed the rock. And then he pointed at the rock and said, for all that will listen to my voice, the Lord is in this place. This, what? The stone, the rock, is none other than the gate of heaven. This is the house of God. So I want to tell you tonight, if you want to experience heaven, it's real simple. It's all about where you lay your head. It's all about where you rest your mind. And God said, if you just rest your head on a stone pillow, you're going to discover the Lord is in this place. And you're going to start perceiving things like you've never perceived in your life. You're about to be persuaded by God Almighty. You're blessed and you're favored. You're above only. You're not beneath. Come on, wave your hand. Say, I'm a world overcomer by the blood of the Lamb and the word of my testimony. The Lord is in this place. And I just didn't know it. But I'm waking up to this reality. You remember the beloved John at the Last Supper? You remember that? 2,000 years ago, the rock was personified and become a man. In Christ, we see the rock. And then we see the beloved John doing what Jacob did many, many, many years before. He took his head and he laid it over upon that rock. And he began to rest his head upon the heart of God, Emmanuel, God with us. And he rested his head. And somebody would say, John, why do you lay your head upon his bosom like that? And John would say, I've discovered the Lord is in this place. When I put my head upon his bosom, I hear heaven, I hear the song of the Lord. Everything changes and everything shifts and everything moves. Even on the inside of my soul, heels melt like wax when I put my head upon his bosom. In his bosom, I can hear the heart of my Father. In his bosom, I know that I am favored. In his bosom, I know there's irrevocable power and glory. There is an anointing that destroys every yoke. The Lord is in this place. And I was sleeping the other night. It was about 4:00 in the morning, and the Lord woke me up. And I don't know if he does you like this, but sometimes the Lord will just wake me up in the middle of the night and just tell me something. And then say, you can go back to sleep now. But you're so excited, your heart is beating. Because man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God shall man live. Lord, you just rocked my world. And the Lord whispered to me and he said, David, you really need to know my heart. If you will let me free you from the politics of ministry, if you'll let me free you from the professionalism of preaching, if you'll let me loose your mind from your reputation and loose your mind from circumstance and situation, if you can flow from my heart, God says, I will work miracles through you. I will demonstrate glory through you. I will heal my people. Oh, not just in their bodies, but I will heal them in their mind, and I'll heal them in their souls, and I'll do extraordinary things through you. And God says, David, if you lay your head on my heart, then I will in turn lay my heart in your head. And when I laid my head or my heart in your head, heaven, you begin to perceive things that you've never perceived before. Everything looks different from his perspective. After 2 days, he'll revive us, but in the third day, he'll raise us up and we'll live in his sight. And God said, you'll see things differently. You'll see yourself different. You'll behold as in a glass the glory of the Lord. Every time you look in the mirror, you see glory. You're not conceited. You're just persuaded that what God has sanctified through the blood of His Son is not dirty. I am blessed. I'm sanctified. I am the glory of God. I'm the living, moving, mobile manifestation of God everywhere I go. Everywhere I go, I bring blessing. Everywhere I go, I bring the anointing of the Lord. Everywhere I go, I bring change in the name of Jesus, because I've been persuaded from His heart. And God said, if you just lay your head in my heart, then I will lay my heart in your head, and immediately your perception, and you'll begin to see some of the things that maybe you've been crying about or worrying about. God says, don't you understand that before you were ever formed in your mother's womb, I knew you. You're not here by accident. You're here by divine design. It's high time that you stop being distracted by all the seeming problems and start trusting in the Spirit of the living God, that I, the Lord your God, will make a way where there seemeth to be no way. I, the Lord thy God, have called you from the morning of time, and my plan will not go unfulfilled in your life. It's time for you to recognize that you're a winner. It's time for you to recognize that you're an overcomer. It's time for you to recognize that I, the Lord thy God, have declared the end from the beginning. It's time for you to perceive. Wave your hands and say, Lord, I want to perceive the reality. Open my eyes, Lord, that I might see. So we got Joseph down in Egypt. And his daddy, Jacob, thinks he's dead. Come on. He sends his boys down there to Egypt to buy food. And you know the story, and Joseph messed with them a little bit, but he's reigning down in Egypt. He's at the right hand of Pharaoh down in Egypt. He's doing very, very well. Because see, sometimes God's working in secret places and you don't understand and perceive, but even while you're laying in your bed at night sleeping, there are angels all around you. The plan of God is unfolding. I'm telling you, glory is in your life. Glory is in your life. And God said, the anointing is upon you this evening to begin to recognize my glory on a level. You're about to confess glory on a level that you've never confessed it. You're about to see glory on a level like you've never. Aging. I heard the Lord say this. Aging. God said the hands of time being turned back and reversed. You're not getting older. You're getting better. That God said the same anointing that was upon Abraham, it's upon your life tonight. God said, I'm turning back time for you. You're going to live long. Long upon the earth. And so they went down for a couple of meetings, and Joseph didn't disclose his identity to his brethren, and he binds up Simeon, says, I'm going to keep him here. I better not see your face, or literally, you won't see my face again until Benjamin is with you. Benjamin, son of my right hand. Joseph, representing Jesus, he'll say to the world, Benjamin, the sons of God who are being conformed to the image and the likeness of this one Son. Those who the veil has been removed from their mind and from their thinking, and they're beginning to recognize, oh, I'm not an old sinner saved by grace. I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And as He is, so am I in this world. I'm not the son of His left hand. No, I'm the son of His right hand. And at His right hand are pleasures forevermore. I am the blessed of the Lord. I am the redeemed of the Lord. The blood of Jesus has made me so. And so Joseph says, you won't see my face again until Benjamin, your younger brother, be with you. And I hear the Lord saying, you can go tell the world, you won't see my face again until this Benjamin company, until I raise up sons of my right hand. Because see, that's what all this favor and grace stuff is all about. grace and favor. What God is saying to you is that you're irrevocably blessed. You're undeniably blessed. The favor of God is upon your life. It cannot be revoked. It cannot be rescinded. It cannot be changed. It is forever settled in the heaven. You can't mess it up. You can't change it. What God has finalized in Christ is complete in Christ, and it'll never be changed. And God said, I'm not telling you that so you can live like the world. I'm telling you that so you'll understand there's nothing in your path that's going to hold you back. You can walk in the fullness of my glory, the fullness of my power, the fullness of my anointing. You can walk in that. You can walk in that. And so he says, you won't see my face again until Benjamin be with you. And so they go back, and there Jacob is now. He's an old man. And he knows and feels, and it seems to him like he's run across hard times. But yet God is working behind the scenes. He thinks his beloved Joseph is dead, but Joseph is not dead. Joseph is ruling and reigning in Egypt. And the thing that the old man holds on to is his youngest son, the prize and possession of his heart, his beloved Benjamin. And the brothers come back and say he kept Simeon. And he says that we can't see him again until the lad Benjamin's got to be with us. And the old man said, no, you're not taking him. No, you're not going to take my beloved Benjamin. This is my heart right here. I feel like he's all I got left. You're not going to take him. No. But Father, the man said that we would not see his face. No, you're not taking him. He's the joy of my life. I don't have anything else. You're not taking him. No. A little duration of time goes by and food runs out. And he says, boys, go back down to Egypt. Get grain, Father. The governor said very clearly that we wouldn't see his face again unless the lad's got to go. And the father says, oh my. Now watch what he says. He said, oh my. Joseph is not, and Simeon is not. They're both dead, and now you're going to take away my beloved Benjamin. All of these things are against me. And the angels bow over the balconies of heaven, if there be such a thing, and they peer out of the windows of glory, and they see behind the scenes that no, all these things aren't against him. All of these things are working together for his good. Now I'm going to prophesy to you, and then you're going to have to prophesy to yourself. But some of the stuff you've been crying about, and some of the stuff you've been whining about, and you said, all these things are against me. And God said, from this night forward, you never need to let those words come out of your mouth again, because I'm going to tell you myself, saith the Lord, they're not against you. God said, I'm behind the scenes, and I'm strategically working in your life, and I'm working it together for your good. I'm going to cause my glory to manifest in you, from your head to your feet, to your family, to your friends, everywhere the sole of your feet will trod. God said, I'm working it together for your good. It's all about your perception. All about your perception. See, Jacob was blind. He didn't see it. It's all about what you perceive. Somebody called me the other night and said, it was a very honest conversation. I appreciated the conversation. They said, God has called me to raise the dead. And I know that in my heart. How does that work? How does what work? How does raising the dead, how does that work? I said, oh, I don't think we could teach that.
Come on.
Are you hearing me? I don't know that I could. You know, how could you teach somebody? I mean, how do you teach someone like a Smith Wigglesworth that he talked about last evening? That what could you say to a man that would persuade him to pick up somebody that's dead and push him up against a wall and say, "Live in the name of Jesus"? And I don't think we can teach that. I think that comes from experience. Yeah. I think it comes from laying your head on a rock until the heart of God so infiltrates your thinking, until the holy power of God begins to stand up in your life and you begin to prophesy because you understand, as He is, so am I in this world. I don't think we can teach that. I think sometimes we try to teach things that only come through experience. Only comes through experience. And so God said, if you lay your head in my heart, then I'll lay my heart in your head. And the Lord said, I'm going to just tell you the truth. The thing that's giving you more of a fit than anything else in your life right now is your perception. It's what you perceive. God thought to teach Abraham something. God said, I'm going to make known the divine secret of my heart. Greatest mystery, greatest secret God had ever kept. And He said, I'm going to tell it to Abraham. And when God started talking to Abraham, you can only imagine that maybe he's sitting in the tent and it's in the evening and the sun is setting and Abraham is looking out through the fields and he's quiet, reserved. And maybe Sarah comes to him one day and says, "Baby, what's wrong?" And he says, "I'm okay. I've just got a lot on my mind." She said, "Yeah, it seems you've had a lot on your mind for the last several days. Baby, what's wrong? You're not talking to me." And he said, "Well, Sarah, I don't want to talk about it right now." She said, "Well, baby, maybe you need to talk about it. You need to talk to me about it. What's going on?" "Really, Sarah, it's not something that I think I want to talk to. It's just something God said. That's all, just something God said." "Well, I've never seen you troubled over something God said." "Who said I was troubled?" "No, you're troubled." "Well, there's just something that maybe I just don't understand. I don't understand everything God says sometimes, and it bothers me." "Well, what did He say?" "Sarah, just let it rest." "What did He say, Sarah?" "Well, Abraham, what did He say?" "Sarah, He said to kill this boy. He said I was. He told me to take my boy. He told me to kill him." "Oh, you must have misunderstood." No, I didn't misunderstand. I heard what He said. "He told me to kill him, sir. I couldn't believe it. I actually heard God say that I was supposed to kill my son, but I heard Him say that He would show me a place and I was to take my son there and I was to kill him." "Well, Abraham, you just tell him no." "Sarah, that's why I didn't want to share it with you." How many of you know the story? Abraham gets up, takes his son, 3-day journey. But God is working behind the scenes. I mean, the anointing has been released out of the heavens, and the angels, they're swirling. There's all kinds of supernatural activity, and the angels don't fully understand why, but their sights are upon a man. They're about to understand something about the heart and the mind of God, and they know that it's being played out like a drama with an old man and a young boy on a 3-day journey to a mountain that God would show them. Then on the 3rd day, he lifted up his eyes and he looked in the distance, and God whispered in his heart and says, "There's the place." He left the servants with the mules at the bottom of the mountain. And we know this, and he spoke by faith and said, "I and the lad will go yonder and we'll come again we'll worship God on this mountain. And as they were going up the mountain, the Bible says that Abraham took the wood and he laid it on Isaac. I wish I had something. I wish I had something. I don't have something. So, but if you can see this picture, he takes the wood and he takes the wood and he lays it here. Lays the wood here. Carry that. And somehow or another, as Abraham was going up that mountain, he looked back at his son and he gets a flash. Something happens in his thinking, and he sees a man. He sees a man battered. He sees a man bloodied. He sees a man with a cross upon his shoulder going up a hill. And Abraham shakes himself. And his son says, "Father, we have the wood and the fire, but where's the lamb for the burnt offering? God shall provide himself." Something is happening. Abraham's faith started to stir. He started to recognize. He started to perceive that there's more working here than just me taking my son to an altar. God's got something to say, and I'm about to hear it. So I'm willing to go anywhere God wants me to go, and I'm willing to do anything God wants me to do, because I've got to hear this revelation. Can you hear my heart tonight? I don't want to read it in a book. I want to experience it for myself. I want to experience the life of his presence. So Abraham, I'll make this story short, but Abraham goes up the mountain and the anointing of God starts to move on him. He starts to feel something about his son, his only son, that he loves more than life itself. He starts to identify with the pain that his heavenly father would one day feel, or even has felt from the very foundation of the world. For God so loved the world that he would give his only begotten son, that whosoever believed in him would not perish but have everlasting life. And they get up there to the mount. And you know the story. Abraham builds an altar. And then he lays his son upon that altar. You don't have to lay down, son. But he lays his son. That's a good boy, isn't it? Hallelujah. He lays his son upon that altar. And as he lays his son upon the altar, and he starts to bind him on that altar, Abraham then takes that knife. And he's feeling this, folks. He's feeling the pain, man. He looks into the eyes of a son. And I'm sure he's looking at Isaac thinking, "I don't understand everything I'm doing right now. I don't understand everything I'm feeling. But if I could trade places with you, boy, God in heaven knows that I would. I wish that it was God putting me on the altar. And I wish the roles were reversed." Can you hear my heart? God says the roles have been reversed in your life. God said, "I put myself on the altar so you wouldn't have to go there." God said, "You can fellowship the sufferings of Christ until you began to experience the reality." I remember one time my baby was feeling really bad. They were just a little thing. It was you, Daniel. And I remember I looked at you, man. You had fever. You were congested. And my heart was just overflowing with love for you. And I sat in my bed and I prayed. And I said, "Oh, God, if I could take his pain, I would. If I could take his sickness, Lord, I'd take it. Let it come on me." And God says, "No, David, you're feeling my heart now. You're feeling the heart of a father, but you don't have to take his sickness and you don't have to take his pain. I already took that 2,000 years ago upon an old wooden cross." I said, "God, what you want me to do?" He said, "Open up your mouth and prophesy the glory and the presence of God over you, son." See, when we begin to perceive this and God lays his heart, see, that's what was happening on that mount. God was laying his heart in a man named Abraham. And Abraham was feeling the heart of his heavenly father. For all of those who say that God didn't orchestrate the death of his son and that God didn't feel, they don't understand that it was God in Christ reconciling the world. The Father and the Son went together to the hill. The Father and the Son were both instrumental in the slaying of the Son. The Father and the Son felt it together. Do you hear my heart? And so he took him and he laid him upon the altar. And then Abraham pulls that knife. And no doubt, Isaac's eyes widened as he looks into the eyes of his father, and he knows that it's the father that's actually going to bring this death wound. And Abraham lifts his knife, and you know the story, and right when he made the commitment, the angel spoke out of heaven and said, "Abraham, oh, that you talk about divine intervention. Abraham, hurt not the lad." And Abraham drops the knife. No doubt his hands are shaking. And while he's wondering what comes next, all of a sudden he hears something. And I think it's highly prophetic. And he looks behind him. And he sees a ram caught in the thicket. God, what are you trying to say? God said, "I'm trying to tell you that you don't have to kill your son because I slew mine from the foundation of the world." Can you hear it? And Abraham walks over to this ram, and he's about to lay hands on this ram to use it as a sacrifice instead of his son, and all of a sudden a scene flashes before him, and he sees this same man that he had previously seen, but now he's down on his knees and he's crying in a garden, and he sees him as he lifts up his hands and says, "Oh Father, I've glorified you on the earth. Now glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory that I had with you before the world began." And Abraham looked back at the ram and he realized this ram is used to freedom. This ram is used to space. He's used to unlimited territory. But now he's caught in the thicket. And now he looks back at this solitary man and he realizes he's used to the omnipresent glory. He's everywhere at one time. But suddenly he finds himself caught in the thicket of humanity. And then Abraham notices that he's caught by his own horns. Horns represents power. And then he looks back at Jesus and knows some way, somehow, even though he's caught in the thicket of humanity, it was his own power that placed him there. He came of his own free will. And he's caught. Did you ever think about this? He's caught in the thicket. He can't get free. He's caught. Death is his only option. He's not going to get free. When Jesus came into this world, do you realize that the omnipresent God robed himself in human form and became a man? And as a man, there were certain restrictions. He grew tired. He grew weary. He hungered. And there he is in those restrictions, but yet there's no sin working in his body. There's no sin working in his mind. There's nothing that could ever take his life. His only option to get out of the thicket and out of the restrictions is that he must lay his life down. But for this purpose came I into this world. He would have died no other way. He had to lay his life down. But aren't you glad that Jesus willingly laid his life down so you and I could take up life in an entirely different dimension? And so Abraham takes the ram and he leads it over. And you know, he's ready for a fight. I don't believe the ram fought with him that day. Abraham reached out his hands and took hold of the ram and untangled it. And to his surprise, the ram willingly is led to the slaughter. And he takes the ram, puts it on the altar, straps it down, takes his knife, plunges it into that ram, and its body goes into convulsion. And he sees that same man hanged, outstretched on the cross. And his body is shaking under the convulsion of sin and sickness and disease and poverty and lust. And he's heaving for breath, hung outstretched on an old wooden cross. And finally, the ram's leg stiffens out and it dies. The life runs out of its eyes. And he sees this man hang his head and die. And Abraham, by this time, is no doubt pouring sweat. What a day. What a revelation. And then while he's pondering all these things, just out of the corner of his eye, it looked like that ram got up from that altar and went back into freedom. Then he catches one more glimpse of Jesus coming forth out of the grave. Free, free, free. Conqueror of death, hell, and the grave. Could you imagine what it must have been like when Abraham went back home and Sarah sitting in the tent door? She's rocking. Could you imagine? That was 3 days of misery for her. Maybe 6 days. 3 to get there, 3 to get back. And she's rocking. She's worried. She's stressed. All the last things she heard, he's going to kill my baby. And then she looks over the horizon, way over there, and she sees that little band coming over the horizon. And she looks up and she sees the wagon and she sees Abraham and she's looking, who is that? Who is? And they get closer and closer, and she realizes that's not just Abraham, but that's Isaac as well. My son of laughter, my baby. It's like I received him back from the dead. That's resurrection life and resurrection glory. Hallelujah. It's just about what you can perceive. See, Abraham rejoiced to see my day,
and he saw it.
And he was glad. You can rejoice to see my day. And you can rejoice. And you can be glad. The night is over. The war is done. The fight has been fought. The victory has been won. This is the day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and we will be glad. You know, it's about what you perceive. I'm done. You have kingdom privileges and benefits. And I don't want you to look over at your neighbor and say it by faith, I will not be silent. I will not be silent. I will prophesy. I will speak. I will decree. I will declare. Because I want to tell you something. I believe with all of my heart that the anointing is upon us to perceive on a level that is unprecedented. We're about to see things that we've never seen. We're about to perceive things that we've never perceived. And we're about to enjoy life as God intended. You got a blind man on the side of the road, Bartimaeus, and he's been in darkness for so long, and one day while he's sitting there, he hears a commotion and he hears the sounds of people and the sounds of shouting, and blind Bartimaeus reaches out. Something stirred. I pray something is stirred in you tonight, but something stirred inside of him. He reached out into the darkness and he felt, and he took hold of somebody and said, what's that sound that I hear? And they said, oh, that's that Jesus of Nazareth. You know, everybody's making a big to-do of him. You know, that it's him, blind Bartimaeus.
It's who? Jesus? Did you say Jesus?
Yes, Jesus of Nazareth. You've heard of him, the guy that many are claiming that he's doing miracles and signs and wonders. Oh, he's got a big crowd. They're following him everywhere.
And he says, Jesus? Did you say Jesus? Jesus! Jesus! Son of David.
You see the perception? No, more than Jesus of Nazareth. Son of David.
Master. Messiah. The one who holds heaven and earth in the palm of his hand. The one who created me from my mother's womb. The one who is here to bring sight. The one who is here to roll all of my pain away. My life is about to be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Right here, right now. Jesus! And they said, oh, blind Bartimaeus, hush, hush. Jesus! Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Don't you understand? The Lord heard that voice, Son of David. He understood there's somebody in this crowd. There's somebody in this place. They perceive who I am. And I'm about to satisfy their desire. Can you hear my heart? God said, you're about to perceive me on a level that you've never perceived me before. And I'm going to satisfy your desire. And they tried to shut him up. Blind Bartimaeus, hush up. Jesus, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Hush, be quiet. But see, there's an issue here. Blind Bartimaeus really needs some help. Do you need help? Is there anybody here that just says, I need the Lord. Oh, I need Him to help me. Oh, when I first got saved, I thought I was King Kong. My God, I was so strong. Oh, but I need the Lord to help me. I used to think, do unto others as you would have others do unto you. Now, no, Lord, do unto me as you would have me do unto others. If you don't do it to me, Lord, then there's no way you're going to do it through me. Love me so I can love the unlovable. Have mercy on me so I can have mercy on people. But I need the help of the Lord. I mean, I really need the help of the Lord. I really, really need Him. Man, I apologize for being late tonight. You know why I was late? You know why? Because I need help. My wife came to me. She said, baby, I'm sitting up in the tub. That's the truth. She said, baby, she said, you know what time it is? I said, oh, baby. I said, I got this. It's all good, baby. I know what time it is. She said, okay. I laid up there in the tub for a few minutes. I got out and I said, hey, baby, I said, I'm just going to go pray for a little bit. She said, well, we just going to be late. I said, no, we ain't going to be late, baby. She said, do you know what time it is? And I said, I think I do. And she said, it's 5:30. I said, my gosh, we're going to be late. We're going to be late. Sure as the... And this is what I figured out. Husbands, why did God give us wives? So we could listen to them, right? Right? Ladies, look over at your husband and say, you better recognize it. I'll help you. Amen. Praise God. But here's my point. I need help. Praise God. You need help. There's never been a time in my life where I recognize my dire need for the help of the Holy Spirit. Everything God's ever shown me, everything God's ever shown that He wanted to do through me, it's like, God, you've got to do this. And the Lord did unto Sarah. This is beautiful, but y'all don't need me to talk about Abraham. I talk about him every time I come over here, but he's an old. He got an old scraggly beard, spittle running. His old eyes are sunk back in his head. He's old. And in Genesis 17, he appears up before the Lord. And I can hear God saying to Abram, you done? Yes, Lord, I'm done. Ain't got nothing left. And God said, good, now walk facing me, for I am the Almighty God. See, you need some help, don't you, son? Yes. And you don't need me to go back through the story. I preached it here, but Lord, things not good between me and Sarah. I really thought going into Hagar would be the right thing to do. I thought maybe I could just help you just a little bit.
Well, how's that working for you, Abram?
It ain't working too good, Lord. It ain't working too good. And now me and Sarah, we don't even sleep in the same bed no more. It's over. It's done.
And something happened now, didn't it? And the Lord touched Abram, his body, and the old shaking hands, you know, old shaking. I want you to see yourself. You were shaking. Oh, circumstance, what they said at the job, just. And all of a sudden, what used to cause the pain, crick, oh, what? My God. God said, quickly, Abraham, go look in a mirror. Go look in a mirror. Go see yourself. You've been rejuvenated by the power. And Abraham goes and looks. And Sarah's still back in the tent. Abraham's on his way. And he goes back into the tent. And it's on a starry night and the moon's full. And he throws back the curtain and the moonlight shining. And Abram's standing there, boy. And Sarah looks up and... And I want to tell you, she got all shook up. And hear my heart prophesying to you. But God said, I'm about to bring some resolve to you. Oh, you're about to stand in the face of some stuff. And you're about to prophesy the glory of God. You're not going to back down. You're not going to back up. You're going to decree a thing. It's going to be established. Still. Still. Be still. And know that I am God. The disciples are in a storm, beating against that boat, and that boat's rocking back and forth, and Jesus in the hinder part of the ship, still. And they went back and woke him up and said, Master, you better come, we're about to die. Jesus gets up, wind, thunder rolling, the little boat's rocking. Jesus walks up and says, peace! Be still and know that I am God. Waves, you're not God. Winds, you're not God. Circumstance, you're not God. Be still and know that I am God. And if you can hear it, God said that same glory is going to stand up on the inside of you. You're going to say to cancer, you're not God. Circumstance, you're not God. Doctor's report, you're not God. Pain in your body, you're not God. Be still. The message says, hush now. Hush. And the Bible says that from the message that the winds ran out of breath. He muzzled it. God is muzzling some things, even in your own heart. Be still and know that I'm God. So we got blind Bartimaeus. Let's get him off the side of the road and we're going to pray. So blind Bartimaeus, he's screaming out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And they're saying, shut up, blind Bartimaeus. And then you got Jesus walking down the road and there's this crowd around him. But you got Jesus, you got this huge crowd, and somewhere back here in the midst of all the voices and the clangoring and the noises is one solitary man. He's blind and he needs help. And he knows who Jesus is and he perceives his glory. And he's crying, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And as blind Bartimaeus releases his voice, it just seems like it just blends in with all the other noises. And it seems like his voice is drowned out. But how many of you know what Jesus did? He's walking down the road and all of a sudden, blind Bartimaeus back there, crowds everywhere. Jesus! And everybody's trying to touch him. And all of a sudden, the Bible says, Jesus stood still. All of a sudden, you could hear a pin drop. The The crowd stops, and Jesus stands there. Now, blind Bartimaeus is on the other side of the crowd, and he's the only voice now. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus, Son of David, if I can paraphrase, I know who you are. I know why you came. I know what you're capable of. Jesus, Son of David, the Master Messiah, have mercy on me. And I can see Jesus turns toward blind Bartimaeus when he did that crowd. Split like the Red Sea. And Jesus says, bring him to me. Alright, he's calling for you. Don't figure at all, but he's calling for all the people. He's calling for you. And blind Bartimaeus did what you and I are doing tonight. He took his old beggar's garment. He cast that thing from him. Says, I won't be needing that anymore. I'm not going to beg from this day forward. He's calling for me. He's calling for me. Can you hear? You've been born into the kingdom of heaven for such a time as this. And he's calling for you. Mimers, you're going to mime and miracles are happening. Singers, you're going to sing and miracles are happening. Praise God. Preachers, you're going to preach and the undeniable, irrevocable glory of God is going to manifest in and through your life. It's a new moment, a new day. There's a refreshing in the presence of God. And we've been born into the kingdom for such a time as this. Stand to your feet with me. Lift your hands before the Lord if you would. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Here's what I want us to pray as we just prepare to receive from the Lord. God said that this is a moment and a time, and it has been ever since Jesus sat down at the right hand of the Father. But I tell you that there's a sense, a uniqueness of the anointing and the presence of God here in this place for this very thing. God said, favor. Favor. God said, not just favor, but recognized favor. Favor that you can see. Favor that you can perceive. God said, some of you are praying that the doors will open, and God said, but now they're already open. I just need you to be able to recognize it. I need you to begin to see it. I need you to get up and spiritually walk through it. I need you to begin to talk and speak from a dimension that's already in. Instead of on the outside looking in, you're on the inside looking out. Favor, blessing. Matter of fact, the healing anointing that began a while ago that brought healing to Sarah's body. Sarah told me, she said, would you look during the fellowship? She said, look, Pastor John, she barely could walk in this place. And when I stood up here in the fellowship, she's leaping. She's leaping. I said, Lord God, put it in her head, put it in her mouth, put it in her heart, put it in every part of her. I decree that it's irreversible. She can't go back. Praise God. Her body can't go back. Praise God. Hallelujah. But that same anointing, not just for us physically, but for us mentally. I wanted to preach tonight that David took the stronghold of Zion. And I really wanted to minister that tonight, that Zion is depicted in the Bible as a people. It's depicted in the Bible as the church. It's depicted in the Bible as a place. But the Lord said to me, God said to me, David, I must take the stronghold of Zion. Because whoever takes your high place is going to be seen in your life. Zion being the highest hill, it's very recognizable. It's conspicuous, if you will. And God said, whatever occupies your mind becomes easily seen in your life. If there's a poverty mentality, it's easily seen. If it's depression, it's easily seen. But if it's the Lord's glory, it's easy to be seen. It'll be seen in your joy and your peace and your creativity and your ability to flow in the anointing of God, whatever occupies your high place. And David took the stronghold of Zion. Some amazing things that I wanted to share tonight. But I sat over there and God says, but none of that means anything without perception. Perception. And I want you to release your faith with me right now. I'm going to pray. And I want you to release your faith with me. that from this very night forward, we'll never ever have the testimony again, the Lord was in this place, but I knew it not. But Lord, our eyes are open. Father, our eyes are anointed with eye salve. The eyes of our understanding are flooded with light. Father, we thank you that we walk enlightened. God, our soul is lit up with the Shekinah glory of your presence and your power. Thank you, Lord, that that same anointing that lights up our soul affects our mortal bodies. And our bodies are strong and vibrant, Lord. Thank you for rejuvenation in this place tonight. Thank you for touching physical bodies and minds in this place. Thank you, Lord, for this favor, this manifest glory of God that was made available through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for that working mightily, God, in all of our lives and all of our hearts. Praise the Lord. You know, when I talk about perception, let me say this. It's very, very important. You take a man of God like John Cahill, and you know, I appreciate it whenever a man like Dale Carver would say about this man and how that he is a scribe that's instructed in the kingdom, and he's got knowledge, and all of that's true, but he's a whole lot more than that. Now, I'll be honest with you, I'm not so impressed with that. Of all the things that I know about John Cahill, I'm least impressed about that. The thing that I'm impressed with this man is his heart. I've been with him in secret. I've watched the tears flow. I've seen what's in his heart and what's in his mind. I've seen the way that he loves his wife, and I've seen the way that he loves his church. I've watched him stand. I've seen him humble himself in such ways that I don't know if you've ever seen it on the level I've seen it, but I've seen the humility of God in this man. And when I look at a man like that, I perceive that if I had some kind of ailment in my body and he put his hands on me, I perceive. You understand? It's more than a knowledge. It's an experience. Okay? I perceive. And even in this place, even in Open Door, I think perception of the glory and the transition that's happening in this man, the more you recognize it, receive a prophet in the name of prophet, you get a prophet's reward. Somebody wave your hands and say, I'm getting my reward. I tell you, there's a unity coming together. There's a union coming together in this place. But it's all going to come through perception. I perceive that out of him. And so, well, he's got great knowledge, and he does, and it's wonderful, but wow, he's so much more than that. I've seen a lot of people that have knowledge, astounding knowledge. But how many of you that know Pastor John Hill can say, I know what you're saying? He's a lot more than that. He's a lot more than that. Just our ability to recognize, perceive. Praise God. You know, whenever I first met Pastor Paul Hurthern, Dale Carver introduced me to him. You know, immediately when I looked into his eyes, I perceived something. And I tell you, my heart just, and me and Pastor John had many conversations about you, sir. And the one thing that he said to me that I recognized in you the first time I ever saw you, what a rare humility. You're a prince of a man. You're a man that has, you have wealth, you have knowledge, you have influence, but sometimes when we tell you how much we love you and what a prince you are, you weep and you shed those precious tears. What a wonderful man. And here's what I'm saying to you. I perceive the glory of God inside of you. And whenever I first met you, I heard the Lord whisper in my ear and say, David, there's the one you've been looking for. Because I don't want to get too much into this, but I have drawn close to people, and then you get close and go, no, I just can't connect to that. But this man was different. And so what does it do? I feel the heart of God for you. And so he takes his heart and puts it in my head. And he says things to me like, I hope this don't sound wrong, but don't you let him go nowhere. You pray. Coming over here tonight, God, whispering in my ear and say, you prophesy over Pastor Paul tonight. And you prophesy long life. You pray strength in his body. You prophesy and you tell him that the best is now. You prophesy and tell him, yes, you will be able to go. Yes, you will be rejuvenated. You prophesy the glory of the Lord. Hallelujah. Because in all of your wealth and all of your knowledge and all of your humility, I hear the Lord saying, I'm bringing you into the best of you. Right now. Right now, in the name of Jesus, everybody stretch your hands this way and let us prophesy. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for the treasure that is in this man. Father, we thank you for the anointing that is in this man. We thank you for the transparency that is in this man. And Father, we prophesy over him health, and we prophesy rejuvenation. Same thing you did to Abraham, Lord, you're doing right now from his head down to his feet, Lord. Thank you for your healing power touching every facet of his physical body. Thank you for giving him energy on a level, God, that he hadn't felt in years, Father. Thank you for the quickening of his mind, Lord, that his mind is sharp, his mind is precise, his thinking, Lord, is all together. We prophesy that in the wonderful and amazing name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Somebody wave your hands. Hallelujah. Oh, we give you praise. We give you praise. We give you praise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just go ahead and praise him for a minute. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm hearing this. Well done, well done, well done. I'm hearing it echo, reverberating in my spirit that there's so many people in this room that the Lord is prophesying and speaking over you. Well done, well done. Where's Thornton at? Is Thornton still here? Is he still here in this room? Where's he at? Thank you, Lord. Thornton, just lift your hands to the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thornton, I just hear the word of the Lord saying, well done. Good and faithful. Good and faithful. And there is an abundant entrance being ministered unto you. You're about to perceive into the kingdom. You're about to perceive on a level the favor of God that's on your life. Thornton, there are some people that are looking for you. And they don't know they're looking for you, but they're looking for you, sir. And the Lord says there's a transformation that's taking place in your thinking. There's an anointing on you this evening. You're about to see yourself in the mirror of God, and you're going to see a reflection like you've never seen before. It's literally going to change your very state, your very being, and you're going to be like a magnet to draw to yourself the very things that God has ordained from the very morning of time. And God says, you are blessed and you are favored. Well done, well done, well done, well done. Well done, well done. Set time to favor you, Thornton. You're a prince, sir. You're a prince of a man. You're a good man. You're a humble man. I hear the Lord saying, it's just men like you that I have chosen to raise up even in this day and even in this hour. And yes, you have been through the fire. And yes, you have been through difficulties. And yes, you have been through things that you didn't understand. But God said, trust me when I tell you, Thornton, I've been working behind the scenes. And I've been doing more work in you. But the Lord says, now I'm doing a work in, but not only in, but I'm doing a work through. You saith the Lord, and the river that flows out of your belly, because there's been a detaching. I know you know what I'm talking about. Some of the things that have troubled, and some of the things that have stressed, and some of the things that have just been disappointing, God has just been gradually weaning you from it, weaning you from it, weaning you from it. Sometimes it just feels like, well, I'll just quit. And God said, but what you're quitting is the circumstance and the situation and so forth. And God said, but here's what's happening. God said, I have purified your soul unto myself, and I have postures you to hear me on a level that you've never heard me before. And out of your mouth and out of your belly, it's going to come answers. It's going to come prophetic glory. And God said it's going to reverberate even in the atmosphere in your region. And people are coming, saith the Lord, and that place will be filled with my glory. Hallelujah. Well done. Well done. Well done. Well done. Hallelujah. There is something, Thornton, that's come out of your loins that's reigning in Egypt. God wants you to know that there is something that has been birthed out of your loins that, and it's a spiritual thing, but it's reigning in Egypt. And God said, these things are not against you. They're working for you, and you're about to see the glory and the power of my right hand. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for your glory. Krista back here at the back, I heard the Lord say something. I may have prophesied this over you before, but I heard the Lord say this, and I want to say this to you. Thank you for being such an amazing and extraordinary daughter. And I heard the Lord say specifically, daughter, not just the daughter of God, but the daughter of John and Teresa Cahill. And the Lord says, I watched you and I've seen your faithfulness. Not just your faithfulness to me, says the Lord, but your faithfulness to your mother and your father. And that's the one command that comes with promise, saith the Lord, that your days will be long upon the earth. But the Lord said to me, tell you to attach Psalm 91 to that. Not only are your days going to be long, but you're going to live long, satisfied days. Satisfied. God said, I will satisfy you with good things all the days of your life. Because God said, when you've done it to these, you've done it to me. Well done. Well done. I hear the Lord saying, well done. Well done. Hallelujah. There's people in this place. This gentleman right here, is your name Graves? Groves? What's your name? Perkins. I'm sorry, I got this gentleman on my mind. But Perkins. But I hear in my heart, sir, just a dynamic shift in your life and in your thinking. And you are born to the kingdom for such a time as this. And I hear the Lord saying there's some stillness about to come to you. Jesus is the man of steel. He's the real Superman. But you're about to experience stillness, resolve on a level. I mean, stuff cross your path and people would normally flinch, and something's rising up on the inside of you that's not going to flinch. You won't bow. You won't back up. God said the only thing that's going to bow and back up are the things that are in your path that were not sent from me. God said you are right on the precipice. You're about to take a step, and it's like taking a step into the unknown glory of God. It would almost feel like it don't have any foundations, but there's something inside of you that's going to scream out, jump. And God said, when you jump into that, God said, it's a leap of faith that you're never going to regret, because you're about to see a dynamic shift. It'll start in your mind. It'll flow out of your belly in the name of Jesus. But I want to tell you something. I don't know you, but you're a good man. You're a good man. You're a good man. You're a man that God can raise up. You know, you're a good man. And God said, this shift is happening. I got you covered, saith the Spirit of the Lord. I got you covered. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Come on, just wave your hands and bless Him. Wave your hands and bless Him. Thank you, Father. We give you praise. We give you honor. Oh, we love you, God. We thank you, Lord, for opening our perception, God. Father, that we will see you, God. We will experience you on a level, God, that's unprecedented. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, I want to conclude with this. God said, I'm talking to you tonight about things that can't be taught. It's an experience in my glory. And just an absolute knowing. I know I've told you this and I'm right out of your way, but when I was 10 years old, the presence and the Spirit and the power of God came on my life. And I did not realize at 10 years old, I knew it was good. But I didn't realize that after I had that experience with God on such a level that I would spend 40, 45 years trying to, forgive my terminology, but to recapture what God did in my life at 10 years old. And I wasn't sin conscious. The only thing I knew about Jesus is what they taught me. Jesus loves me. This I know. For the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves the little children. All the little children of the world, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious. And I knew I'm precious in His sight. And it was so easy. I would lay in my bed and I could just see Jesus and I would ask Him, Jesus, do this and do that. And you may have heard me tell this. Take 2 minutes. But one night, I mean, I was 10. I had never stayed up past 12 o'clock. I'm like, man, I would like to cross over into that unknown. I'd like to know what it feels like to be awake after 12 o'clock at night. So I'm going to bed one night, 9 o'clock, and I laid my head on the pillow, and I said, Jesus, wake me up between 2 and 3 in the morning. And then I laid my head on the pillow, and I said, see you between 2 and 3. And I knew it. And I laid my head on the bed, on the pillow, went to sleep. And you know how it is when you're 10, you almost go into a coma. Yeah, you go in that real deep sleep, right? And I went into one of those kinds of sleeps. And sometime during the night, I heard my daddy's voice, my earthly daddy, David! And I couldn't hardly get woke up. David! David! And finally, I got up. And I went in my daddy's room and I said, sir, he's a son. Make that dog outside shut up. He's that thing barking right under my window. I can't go to sleep. I'm like, yes, sir. And I walked outside. I'm still half asleep. And I'm like, wait a minute. We ain't got no dog. I didn't hear no dog. I didn't see no dog. And I staggered back in, went in there and went to sleep. Went and jumped back to bed. As soon as my head hit the pillow. I looked up to heaven and I said, I know it's somewhere between 2 and 3 o'clock. I'll just guarantee it. I jumped up and I ran in the living room and I turned on the light and I looked at the clock and it's 2:30. I said, wow, that's really impressive. And I found out God was very detailed. And then you fast forward 30 years into the future and I'm sitting in my prayer chamber and I'm chucking away. Ah, you great God. Almighty. Hallelujah. There's none like you, God. And all of a sudden, God pushed rewind. And I went all the way back to 10. And I said, God, why is it that you did more for me then and it seemed like it then got difficult? God, why did it get difficult? And God said, oh, David, you become complicated. I said, really? He said, oh yes, you become very complicated. You need to go back to the days that Jesus loves me. This I know. Jesus loves the little children, all the little children of the world. You just got really complicated. You know, we do that. We do that. Didn't you guys enjoy Dale Carver last night? You felt that old-timey Pentecostalism coming. Sometimes we just complicate things and put it in a box and we make, well, that's not right and that's not right. You got to say it's in the now, bro. You know, all that stuff. We get it so complicated. And the Lord said, David, just let me simplify your life. You just need to perceive that I'm your Father. And I love you. And I love you all the way, and I love you all the time. Praise God. And God is returning us to that kind of perception. Hallelujah. Where these are going to be the easiest days. Hallelujah. Dale Carver, God says, it's going to be the easiest days of your life, sir. I just want to prophesy that over you in the name of Jesus. The easiest days of your life. Praise God. Doors are opening, but there are doors in the realms of spirit. All the other, man, that'll be easy. Thank you. Give the Lord a praise tonight, brother.
All right, give the Lord a shout. Hallelujah. God's good. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. We perceive who you are. Father, thank you for an amazing day. Thank you for amazing grace and favor, peace that just not only ministers, but it manifests. And then so sweetly and yet so powerfully multiplies tonight. Thank you that we receive. We just receive. We just drink and we receive in Jesus' name. And we all said together, amen. Kind of funny, I feel like I haven't been here all day. Wow. Boy, it's been a long day, but it's a good day. It's a blessed day. I rode about 500 miles today and partook in a funeral, and all is well. God is good, and we are not stressing, just resting in Christ. God is good. Amen. All right, we're going to fellowship in just a moment. And in the morning, 9:30, we're having fellowship time, coffee and fellowship in the morning. 10 o'clock for all of you who can come and would like to come. If you're not working, please come. We're going to have ministry time and worship. We're going to take communion together, pray for one another as we leave, and we are going to celebrate the Lord in our going. As we did in our coming, we're going to celebrate the Lord in our going. Amen? And normally that Monday morning service is very, very, very special. And we're going to have a wonderful time. So you're invited and encouraged to come in the morning. I'll be ministering. Brother David will be doing communion. The Sloans will be ministering worship. We're going to have a great time. At 9:30, Krista will be preparing what we call Cafe 10, but it's at 9:30 in the morning. And God bless you. Tonight, ushers, come stand with me. Our offering goes to our speakers. Everything is met. The needs are met. You've been very gracious and kind. Thank all of you. But tonight, what we give will go to our three speakers and to bless the Sloans. And just to, I want to do more than we can do. If we stop tonight, I can bless them, but I want to do more. Just to say thank you. I love ministry. I love to honor ministry, and I love to give. I love to give. Giving is a joy and a pleasure. So sow a good seed with me tonight, and let's believe God. I've got a seed in my hand. So let's agree and bless the food. And when we go back there, fellowship with somebody you don't know, praise God. Make a new friend. Fellowship with people you don't know. It just doesn't do us any good to come together and set apart. Right? All right. Praise God. I love and appreciate you. In the name of Jesus, Father, thank you for this amazing day. Thank you for the word that I heard tonight that I walked in on. Thank you for my perception being so heightened and so aware of who you are, what you're doing in my life. You're changing me. That I would be resting rather than fretting and struggling, but resting in your love, resting in your amazing grace. Thank you for the good reports I heard this morning, for what I see tonight. Thank you. We sow this seed in love. We bless this food. We're healed and strengthened in our body. And our fellowship time is sweet and sanctified. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. And we all said together, amen. Well, bless the ministry. Sow a good seed. Food's available. And we'll see you there and in the morning, 9:30. God bless you.